Estás escuchando Los Presidios Podcast.
Vengo desde el barrio, vengo desde el barrio.
Segundo barrio. Welcome to another program of Los Presidios Podcast, where we're going to be talking about three topics: history, community, and culture. And today we're going to be listening to a recording from Fred Morales, a historic lecturer of the Rio Chamizal dispute, the Chamizal settlement. Thank you for listening to Los Presidios Podcast.
My name is Fred Morales, and I'm going to be here for about an hour to give you a comprehensive, in-depth report on the Chamizal settlement and how it related to Bowie High School, and in particular to when President Lyndon Baines Johnson and President Adolfo López Mateos of Mexico met on the school grounds on September 1964, which is tomorrow. And that'll be the anniversary of that important event, which I might say was the most controversial issue ever between Mexico and the United States. And it started as far back as the 1860s. And finally, because of President John F. Kennedy, it was resolved by 1962. I have written extensively on the Chamizal dispute. A book should come out hopefully next year on it. It's a very large, probably 200 to 300 page document. And I cover the issue from its inception. And let me first start off as to how it started and how we got to the event in 1964 at Bowie High School. First of all, let me say the word chamizal comes from a plant called the chamisa, or they call it chamiso, or in botanical terms, they call it the four-winged saltbush. It has four petals, and it's similar to this one. And this one has four petals. And that plant grew extensively in this region. And because of the plant that grew in the area, they named the surrounding vicinity El Chamizal. Now, the whole issue started when South El Paso and Cordova Island were then a part of Mexico. Or in the old days, when Juarez, it used to be called Paso del Norte. So what happens? What triggers the controversy? Well, in 1814, a settler named Ricardo Bruzuelas settles on a tract of land when Mexico is still under Spanish authority. And he built a 20-room rancho, which is even bigger than the MacGuffin home. And he built it in a square, and it had a little plaza in the middle. And he had quarters for his farm workers. He grew livestock. He had farm fields. He had an acequia, or an irrigation ditch, which flowed from the Acequia Madre, the main irrigation ditch in Paso del Norte of Ciudad Juarez. And that branch acequia was nicknamed the Acequia del Chamizal. Now, the word chamizal goes as far back to the early 1800s, when Paso del Norte divides the city into eight political wards, or what we call political districts. Like, we have eight single districts that we vote for aldermen, where over there they were called partidos, and they would vote for their aldermen and their alcalde, or for the ayuntamiento de Paso del Norte. So the whole area encompassed everything north of the Acequia Madre to what is now Chihuahuita, a slice of the Segundo Barrio, and then it would mainly taper off. The easternmost boundary would be, I would say, if you ask me, more or less, would be several blocks east of present-day Constitución Street in Ciudad Juárez. So all that was a Chamizal ward, and that's why when he received the Spanish land grant later in 1818, it did mention that his ranch, of which he had been living for 4 years, was located in the Partido El Chamizal. So then after that, other settlers would settle in the disputed area that would be disputed later in the so-called Chamizal district. And probably, I would say, maybe more than 50 land grants were awarded in the Partido Chamizal. And one of the oldest ones was the one awarded to Ricardo Bruzuelas. So where was that land grant located? Well, I have a map of it, and it pinpoints the boundaries, and it shows that it was located in the historic district of Chihuahuita. So what's going to create a controversy later in this Partido del Chamizal is the Rio Grande River, or the Rio Bravo del Norte, as Mexicans call it, because the river is coming south, it's changing course, it's meandering, and basically in the early 1800s, the river is flowing on present day in between San Antonio and San Francisco Street. Then by the 1830s, it's flowing on present day Paisano Street, used to be called Second Street. And then by the 1850s, it's flowing on 7th Street. Now, then it's starting to take land away from the Bruzuelas land grant. It's washing away his land grant. And now his land, some of it will be on the north side of the river. And then after the Mexican-American War, the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo stipulates this is the new boundary. Everything north of the river now belongs to the United States of America. So that triggers the land grant dispute. But let me say, in 1827, the land grant was transferred to a very prominent member, an influential politician in Juarez named Lorenzo del Barrio. And then later in the around 1865, it falls into the hands of Pedro Ignacio Garcia. And by the 1860s, the Garcia land grant is now all of it on the U.S. side of the river. So what happens in 1865? Who arrives at the border? Don Benito Juarez. He's fleeing from the French. He sets up a headquarters in Ciudad Juarez. And during that time, there was a ferryman that operated a boat traversing the river, the Acosta brothers and Jesus Serna. Now, the ferry boat transported passengers from Franklin to Paso del Norte. And one time, Don Benito Juarez came to the ferry boat, and he was approached by the Fort Bliss general at the time. And they have a conversation. And by then, the river is located on 8th Street, more or less, a little bit south, in between 8th and 9th Street. I always say it's located at 1007 South Santa Fe Street because I lived there 2 years. But approximately there, he is told, look, we'll give you asylum. If the French come to Paso del Norte and you feel your life is in danger, cross the river and you can stay in the old Simeon Hart residence that was located near the river further upstream. And this was a response that Don Benito Juarez gave to the general. Look, as long as there's a foreign army in Mexico, I will never cross into a foreign country. So he refused the offer. But Pedro Garcia approaches Don Benito Juarez with the issue of his land. And Don Benito Juarez addresses the concern to officials in Washington, D.C. through his diplomats. During that time, Abraham Lincoln is president. And for a period, also, the wife of Don Benito Juarez is living in the U.S. on the East Coast, I think in Boston or someplace up there. And she gets invited and she goes to the White House as a guest of Abraham Lincoln. And during all this time, Juarez representatives are talking to Lincoln and the State Department about the issue, but it doesn't get addressed. And the issue will be postponed under every president after Lincoln. In my document, I'll cover all the different presidents that were approached with the issue and what was their response, and it was always the same. It was not addressed. So what happens after that? Pedro Garcia gets frustrated around 1895, 1896. He files a suit in a Juarez primary court of claims, and that officially starts the Chamizal dispute. And then later, again, during the presidencies of Taft and others, it gets postponed. And then finally, they're going to settle and decide that they want arbitrators from both countries to sit down and form a boundary commission to discuss not only the Chamizal issue, but other issues that were involving bancos, where you had the Rio Grande River through accretion or avulsion, meandering and changing course, and sometimes the property would end up on the south side of the river or the north side of the river. And as you went along, you had the Chamizal area, and you had the Weber Banco near Washington Park or Modesto Park. You had the San Lorenzo Banco, and you could go all the way to Brownsville and have a lot of similar cases. But the Chamizal issue is the main issue of all the issues on the border involving Mexico in the U.S., where you have a lot of hearings going on. So finally, in 1911, they decide to hold hearings in the federal courthouse here in El Paso. The federal courthouse then was located where the old Crest building is right now. And Ensign Mills is elected the boundary commission on the U.S. side. And on the Mexican side, Fernando Beltrán y Puga. And they had an arbitrator from Canada called Eugene Lafleur. Am I pronouncing it right, Bob? You've been over there, right? Okay. So they felt that this would be a good body to be deciding what would be the outcome of the Garcia case. And during the Battle of Juarez of May 8th to the 10th of 1911, around that time, they were going to have the first hearings pertaining to the Chamizal dispute, but they were postponed because of the battle, because stray bullets, they're flying all over the place, and some even hit the federal building. So they dismissed the commission that was the arbitrators, and they even go to witness the battle. So when the battle is over, the hearings resumed. And what was discovered during this time was that the Mexican government wanted Anson Mills to be disqualified, that he shouldn't serve. And why? It was discovered that he owned land in the Chamizal zone, and it was located right across Sacred Heart Church. So they tried to dismiss him on that issue, but it failed. So they went ahead and they let him remain. And then finally, around June something, a decision was reached, and it was mostly in favor of Mexico. And the arbitrator, the Canadian arbitrator LaFleur, had ruled that that they had decided that they felt that the new boundary should be the old river channel that used to be located in between 1852 and 1864. But the problem was nobody knew or had maps to prove where the channel in around that time period flowed. So they made some estimates and they came to an agreement, both sides, that this is more or less where it flowed, and they wanted to have the U.S. and Mexico abide by that decision. But Ensign Mills cried foul. He didn't agree with it, and they left the hearings. So nothing was ever settled. So let me tell you something, folks. It should have been settled that year in 1911. Because the current riverbed channel that was later decided in the 1960s is the same channel that was decided in 1911. And then again, it goes through the administrations of Theodore Roosevelt, Truman, Eisenhower, you name it. It went through all of them. So finally, President Kennedy was approached with the issue. And he said, look, it's about time we settle this for once and for all. It's been going on forever. And it's been a thorn between Mexico and U.S. relations. So he and President López Mateos have several hearings in California. And one time, Kennedy and his wife traveled to Mexico City, and Kennedy is greeted by a throng of 1 million Mexico City residents. I mean, the streets were packed through downtown Mexico City. And during that event, the wife of John F. Kennedy made a very impressive speech in Spanish. And she was very much applauded. And the Kennedys, if you might recall, just like President Biden, they're Roman Catholic. So that was another reason why he was very warmly received. And they visited the Basilica de Guadalupe. So what happens later, after a treaty is finally signed in Washington and in Mexico City in the early 1960s, well, let me say the treaty was announced on July 18, 1963, and the Chamizal Convention was then signed on August 29, 1963. And then the following year, the Senate ratified the treaty. And by then, the International Boundary Commission, headed by Joseph Friedkin, and the Mexican Commissioner Joaquin Bustamante Redondo of Mexico, were given the task of implementing the terms of the agreement. And as I said before, they had decided to agree on the 1911 decision. And they felt that the way that I'm saying to you right now, that it should have been accomplished that same year also. So the blame really goes to Ensign Mills for the treaty being postponed for at least 5 decades. He was the one that was mostly involved vehemently against Mexico not getting its fair share of the settlement. And Mills, who I admire, let me say Mills is quite a character. He has an impressive resume, a famous general. Because of him, our city is named El Paso. He plotted the city in 1859, and he owned a lot of property here. And he was involved in many circles in El Paso, the business circle, the political arena. He belonged to many groups here in El Paso. He was quite a figure. But anyway, going back to President Kennedy and López Mateos, what happens later? President Kennedy comes to El Paso on June 5th, I think of 1963, was it? And he comes to the Hotel Cortez. He spends a night. On his entourage is Governor Connally, Vice President Lyndon Baines Johnson. And they didn't address the Chamizal dispute that much. Why? Because they knew it was a hot potato then, and it was in the period of being finalized. And then the former mayor, Raymond Tellez, who then was a ambassador to Costa Rica, was also involved in the meetings here in El Paso with John F. K. And an event that happened in the hotel that I might add also that I found a little humor to it was one time Johnson and I think Connally and other important officials, they got on the freight elevator to go up to the upper floors of the hotel. And for some reason, the elevator got stuck. I mean, they couldn't do nothing. So they cried for help and it arrived. And the Secret Service, they had to pry open the elevator doors and stuff. Or I don't know, they had to crawl from atop. So they finally were freed. But that was quite a day and quite a night for the president. And I've covered that presidential visit very thoroughly in other tours that I've done in the past. But anyway, so they finally decide in California in early 1964, hey, look, we already have started the process for informing residents in the Chamizal zone who's going to be affected. We're going to have to start acquiring properties. We're going to have to start the relocation process. And it creates a lot of turmoil. Let me explain to you. Like, I myself was a victim of the Chamizal relocation. I used to live in the Rosarito apartments, bounded by 7th, El Paso, and Oregon streets. It's not part of a parking lot of the INS facility, just crossing El Puente Santa Fe. But basically, all the affected area covered mostly a chunk of Chihuahuita, very little, and everything in South El Paso, mostly south of 9th Street, with the exception of property on Stanton Street and property on El Paso Street, to make way for the bridges and the port of entries and everything involved in the international crossings. Relocation offices are started. One is in Cordova Island in the barrio of El Diablo. One is located on what I thought was South Oregon Street. I later found out was on another location. I don't want to identify it, because it's in a mural that they made a mistake, I think, in the Chamizal Community Center. But anyway, I made a mistake because the newspaper said it was on South Oregon Street. So later I did more extensive checking, and I know where it was located. But basically, it's going to affect also El Barrio del Diablo in Cordova Island. So it's Chihuahuita, the southern end of the Segundo Barrio, and half of Cordova Island. So they decide so many acres go to Mexico, so many acres to the United States, according to the treaty. So everybody's now happy, with the exception of who, can you guess? Who is very upset?
Vista residents?
The who?
The Rio Vista residents?
No.
No.
Even more, I'll go into that. The descendants of Pedro Ignacio Garcia, who started the Chamizal dispute by filing a lawsuit. Why is he upset? He's not even invited to the ceremonies. He's not even compensated for the land that he lost. He's forgotten completely. Now, good thing you mentioned Rio Linda. It did affect Rio Linda. As I said, it covered everything south of 9th Street. But Rio Linda is a different exception. Rio Linda came later. It was plotted in 1945, 46, and 47, more or less. The first editions are late. And that was also affected area. And what's interesting, the neighborhood of Rio Linda was the last settlement to be demolished. Why? Even after the new channel is built, the old homes are still on the Mexican side of the river. So finally, they demolish the site, and it becomes the site for La Feria. It's a yearly large exhibition that they have every year. They just had it, I believe, where the big X is right now on the Mexican side. But before that, it used to be there. And then later, they transfer it to Elequis. And the site, the former site of Rio Linda, would be a site for at least 700,000 people would congregate to welcome the Pope. Remember that? And they call it El Punto. So let me go back and we're going to deal with Bowie High School and how it was connected with the Chamizal dispute. The hole in the wall was at the end of Eucalyptus Street where Bowie High School Stadium is. All the adobe residents that were there, they were demolished, including several where Chinese residents resided and bootleggers. You probably know that, Bob. The Peyton Packing Company was demolished, but the old water tank is still visible on the Chamizal side of Ciudad Juarez. The barrio of El Diablo, 90% of it was destroyed. South Hammett Street was the main business district street in there. There's still a section of El Diablo. If you go further down, what is that? A water treatment plant there or the sewage plant? Boone Street, those homes were in that area. I can't remember the streets. They're part of the old Diablo. And the Paisano projects that were demolished were part of El Diablo. They were called El Diablo. So basically, the only thing that remains there, Bob, I think it's all gone. But there used to be a laundromat and certain structures. They were the last ones. And they're now gone. They're not too far from the Cordova Bridge Processing Center. It's a parking lot right now. And it's right across Paisano Street from that San Javier, or what's the name of that church?
San Javier.
San Javier Catholic Church. But it was wiped out, like Rio Linda. What was wiped out in the Segundo Barrio was 9th and 10th Street, Rio Linda, a chunk of Bowie High School, a chunk of what used to be Hart School also, and everything south of the 1100 block of South Park Street.
Estás escuchando Los Presidios Podcast.
Well, I woke up this morning to the door I did go. I found that I was living in old Mexico. I got the chamizal blue, just as blue as I can be. Because somebody came and took my house away from me. Well, I was born in America in El Paso, and now I'm a citizen of old Mexico. I got the chamizal blue, just as blue as I can be. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because somebody came and took my house away from me. Well, it's very confusing as you can see. Won't somebody please bring my country back to me? Got the chamizal blues, just as blue as I can be. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because somebody came and took my house away from me.
Estás escuchando Los Presidios Podcast.
They also knocked down the old Border Patrol headquarters that was on Hammer Street. They had a detention facility there. And there was the IMAX trucking company. And, you know, the old Navarro school. And so, well, you know what? The old Border Patrol detention facility is part of the Lopez Mateo school on the Mexican side. And the old Navarro school is part of the old Planta de Servicios de Agua de Ciudad Juárez. I can't remember that school on the street on the Mexican side. But it's a continuation of Hammer Street. No sé si es la calle de la universidad that crosses in there. Thank you for bringing that up. Okay, let me go back to the year 1964. So what happens that year? Well, as I forgot to say, Kennedy is assassinated in Dallas. So then Lyndon B. Johnson has to pick up the ball. So in 1964, in September, it is announced, or even earlier than that, that they're going to come dedicate one of the international bridges. And that's going to be what they call the Good Neighbor Bridge, which nobody calls it that. It's now called the Staunton Bridge. So there's where the first ceremonies are held in 1964. And Lopez Mateos and President Johnson, they met their folks, and thousands of people were there. I mean, I saw it myself with my own eyes. What I saw was maybe hundreds of thousands of people, I mean, crammed like sardines on the Staunton Bridge and even further down Staunton Street. And then after they finished with their event there at the bridge, and they had, you know, a big ceremony, and they had representatives from both sides of the river, they decided that from there they're going to go down 9th Street towards Bowie High School. And there's where I was on 9th Street, where I saw the procession pass by. Johnson was in a big black limo, you know, had those bulletproof windshield glass. But you could still see him. They were kind of stained. And he's waving to all the crowd. And on 9th Street, it's packed like crazy. And then the motorcade turns on Park Street, on where Hart School is. Then it comes down here to the, I don't know if it was 6th Street. And then it came to the old Bowie High School. And let me tell you, all that area was overcrowded also. The police cordoned off the area. So all that people that were at the bridge or 9th Street or in all South El Paso, hundreds of, over 100,000, they were not allowed into Bowie High School. Only at least, I would say, 15 to 20,000 people. What happened was that it was mostly reserved for VIPs. So, like the whole front section, You have all these dignitaries from both countries, all these officials from the International Boundary Commission, and everybody that was involved and invited guests, the mayors, the governors from different states. And while they're there, they dedicate a mirror finish monument that they're later going to place at the Santa Fe Bridge. And what had happened before that, President López Mateos had landed close by in a helicopter. They turned, I don't know if it was Skidmore Field or what is now called Montes Field, or somewhere in there it landed. And when the ceremony was done, he took off in the helicopter, and then Johnson went back to the airport. So that would be the beginning of festivities involving the Chamizal dispute. But let me tell you, folks, the event took place in the rear of the buildings that are located here on this campus. It's the athletic field. It's where all the grass is planted. On that site, never in the history of the United States have you had not only one president, the U.S. president, but a foreign president from a foreign country, in this case Mexico, unite and get together and hold a historic ceremony. I do not know of any high school in the country where you had two different presidents meet. I know presidents of the U.S., they've probably gone to a lot of schools and colleges and so forth, but you've never had two presidents. And on that field, that was the field where the 1949 Bowie Bears baseball championship team practice. Now, that's another story by itself that I would like to also address on a future lecture. But that baseball team encountered many dilemmas on its way to win the state title, and it was the first time that an all-Mexican team had ever won such a prestigious title. And it was really, I don't never like to get involved and use the word racial. It had racial overtones to it. But during those times, there was a lot of prejudice. And after the game, when the students boarded the buses, the fans, they threw stones at them, racial slurs. They were bombarded and plastered. They had to get the hell out of their bus. If it weren't for the police that protected them, there could have been some injuries. It was that bad. And then they're going to dedicate in 1967. But this time, López Mateos is not in the picture. It's President Díaz Ordaz. So he comes with Lyndon B. Johnson in 1967. And I was there. They first dedicate the, well, they call it the Paso del Norte Bridge, which most people don't call it that, just government officials. And they will later dedicate the Cordova Bridge, which they call BOTA, or the Bridge of the Americas, which nobody calls it that. It's known as El Puente Libre, the Free Bridge, or El Puente Cordova. And during those events, thousands of people also showed up. And you know, at the Santa Fe Bridge, the mirror finish monument, it looks like a little obelisk. You've probably seen it. That they dedicated here at the old Bowie High School. That's placed at the Santa Fe Bridge. Now, it was there for several decades. It's no longer there. You probably are aware of that. Nobody knows where it is. Some say it's in storage, that it's going to be refurbished and placed later. You know, there's so much history on our international border. I've done tours on the Chihuahuita Levee in the old Smeltertown area near Monument Number 1. And I thank the Border Patrol for giving me permission to do that. They rarely do that. But let me get back to the Chamizal. So in 1967, at the Cordova Bridge, both presidents, Díaz Ordaz and Johnson, they're both raising flags for each respective countries with their respective wives. And after that, they go back to Ciudad Juárez. And you know, in the Chamizal Park, they got a park over there with a sculpture of Don Benito Juárez, you know, with a nice monument. You know where the monument is? Wow. Well, you need to go over there and check it out. It's a beautiful park. And that was dedicated. And it cost a lot of money. A lot of marble was poured in there. But nowadays, if you go there, that park is really abandoned. It's in bad shape. But you think 1967 was the last year that both presidents are going to come to the El Paso Juarez area? No, folks. In 1968, they come again. But this time, they're going to dedicate the new river concrete channels below the river. They gave a name to the channel. It was named after one of the boundary commissioners. I can't recall. And basically, the concrete started in Chihuahuita at the Leon Wasteway. You know, that was also the site where later the tortilla curtain was put there in 1977. So where the concrete starts, the concrete would go all the way and not end until passing the Cordova Bridge, mostly all the way to near Concepcion. And the Bowie Band was involved in the festivities, which included they would go to the Paso del Norte Hotel and have an elaborate ceremony or a banquet. And the Bowie Band was opposite the hotel, the street, performing music for the event. So, when I mentioned the tortilla curtain, it follows the same concrete channel. And that was the brainchild of Henry Kissinger. Remember him? The former Secretary of State. Can't remember, was he under Nixon or some other president? And it costs $1 million, which is cheap compared to today. Now, that tortilla curtain was replaced by the recent, what I call, Trump wall. Now, you have three walls in Chihuahuita. You had the tortilla curtain, the Trump wall, and another wall that was built earlier during the Obama administration. I call that wall the Obama wall. It starts at the Chihuahuita part, and then it heads toward, all the way kind of look towards Hartsmill. It's still there. I don't know how much was appropriated for that wall, but Chihuahuita can boast of at least three different barriers to deter illegal immigrants, and they all started construction in Chihuahuita. Now, what makes it unique in Chihuahuita, since the walls of barrier start there, it's not really effective at all. Why? Because there's a gap in that area where you don't have a wall. But the reason why you don't have a lot of illegal crossings was after 1993, Operation Hold the Line or Blockade implemented a new strategy where they would have more agents stationed at the border to deter the immigrants. And it's been a successful strategy. But nowadays, since there's this gap in there. That's where all the Venezuelans are coming there right now. What is it, 1,000 a day? I haven't had a chance to go down there and check it out. But Chihuahuita not only is the origin of the Chamizal dispute, it was one of the largest crossing points along the U.S.-Mexico border, even for a time surpassing San Diego-Tijuana. And then San Diego-Tijuana became the largest crossing point. So it's very interesting. And with that, I'd like to conclude and thank you all for coming.
Estás escuchando Los Presidios Podcast.
Until you understand what happened back then, you won't be able to build a future. The future is going to be built based on what you know about your true past, yeah, your true history. If you can't figure out at least as close as possible to what was happening back then, the future is still going to be a gray area.